Hello everyone. In the previous video, we talked about plant tissues. In this video, we'll be discussing about animal tissues and specifically about epithelial tissues. On the basis of functions they perform, animal tissues can be classified into different types such as epithelial tissue, connective tissue, nervous tissue and muscular tissue. This video will be about epithelial tissue. Epithelial tissue is really important tissue in our bodies. Epithelial tissue lines all our body and it also forms glands. It is the covering or protective tissue and it covers most organs and cavities within the body. It also forms a barrier to keep different body systems separate. For example, lining of mouth, lining of blood vessels, lung alveoli, the skin, kidney tubules, etc. Now just imagine what will happen if there are no spatial boundaries. That means, what if there is no skin? And if there are no lines separating different organs. Can you imagine the situation? I try to visualize it with the skin but without the organs and cavity lines. Don't you think it will look something like this? In fact, the worst case will be beyond imagination. It's because without skin, even the physical existence is in question. To make it clearer, there is an analogy of epithelial tissue with polythene bags. Or any other container which can be used to carry vegetables. I compared the epithelial tissue with poly bag. Now different vegetables are carried in different poly bags, just like different organs are visible because of the epithelial tissue in our body. The lining makes the visibility of different organs clearer. And in the second situation, suppose there is no epithelial tissue. In that case, just imagine no cavity lining, no organ separation, no skin. So can you imagine the situation?
Can you notice that in my slide I still have the skin and just have a look at the body. I am not able to make out where the organs are, but just imagine if the skin is also not there. What will happen? How will you even imagine the existence of a body of animal structure?
So I could not make a slide of that.
So we can say that epithelial tissue provides the first line of protection from physical, chemical and biological wear and tear. The cells of an epithelial tissue act as a gatekeeper of the body, controlling permeability and allowing selective transfer of materials across a physical layer. Now here is a very important term that deserves attention, that is selective permeability.
Selective permeability is a process which allows only certain molecules to enter and exit the body and blocking others. Many epithelial cells are capable of secretion and release mucus and specific chemical compounds onto their apical surface, and they are called glands. Okay, for now enough of the introduction about epithelial tissue. Now let's dive deeper. We can divide epithelial tissue into two types, membranous epithelial and glandular. Membranous epithelial covers and lines the external surface of our body as well as lining of all internal cavities, organs, tubes and passageways. Glandular epithelium, however, is specialized epithelial tissue that produces and secretes substances such as sweat, stomach acid, mucus and hormones. Despite there being many different types of epithelial tissues, all epithelial tissues have just five characteristics. These are cellularity, polarity, attachment, avascularity and regeneration. So let's talk about cellularity first.
What does cellularity mean? It means that epithelial tissue is made up of tightly packed cells, whereas in other types of tissues, the cells are spread apart and separated by some extracellular material. Another cell characteristic is polarity. Cell looks different at the top than at the bottom. Epithelial cell display attachment. This is the third characteristic. Attachment means that the basal surface of the cells are attached to a special layer called basal lamina or basement membrane. Epithelial tissue is also avascular. Avascular means it does not have its own blood supply. This means that the epithelial tissue must get its nutrients by diffusion from capillaries, which are found in the underlying connective tissues. Then the final characteristics of epithelial tissue, that is repair and regeneration. Epithelial tissue can repair and regenerate itself much better than other tissues of the body. And this is really important because we often cut, scratch or damage epithelial tissue. Suppose we have a cut on our body and if the cells are not able to regenerate, what will happen? The person may die. These characteristics will help us identify the epithelial tissues throughout our body. Although we may have different types of epithelial tissue within our body, but all the epithelial tissues provide four key functions. They provide protection, they control permeability, they provide sensation, and they produce secretions. So these are the four main functions. Our skin is a great example of epithelial tissue that protects our body. It is made up of layers of cells for greater protection. Epithelial tissue controls permeability. It tightly regulates what can pass through the body. For example, our skin is relatively impermeable, meaning most substances cannot easily go into our body. But this is not the case in the epithelium that lines our intestine. This epithelium is much thinner, as it allows for water and nutrients to pass easily through while keeping bacteria out. And this is how we can say that epithelial tissue is selective permeable. Epithelial tissue has a really rich nerve supply. Now this is really important, because these nerves gather really very important sensory information such as pressure, pain, temperature. By being able to detect such sensations, it can actually stop us from hurting ourselves. Some epithelial tissues are highly specialized and they are capable of producing secretions. These could be single cell secretions. More often, these secretory cells form epithelial glands. These secretions are to be released into ducts and then discharged onto the surface of epithelium. Now we can call these glands exocrine glands, and most common examples include our sweat glands and our salivary glands. Secretions can also be released into surrounding tissue and blood, and we call these glands endocrine glands. An example of endocrine gland is thyroid gland. So in summary, we have learned that although there are many different types of epithelial tissues, all epithelial tissues have same five characteristics. They are cellularity, polarity, attachment, avascularity, and regeneration. In addition, we have also learned, although there are many different types of epithelial tissues, they have the same basic four functions. That is, they provide protection for the body, they control permeability, regulating what comes in and what stays out to provide us with sensation, to enable us to detect temperature and pain, and also to produce secretions for the body. Now let's talk about membranous epithelium. Membranous epithelium can be classified into different types based on the following two features. Firstly, the number of layers present, and secondly, the shape of the epithelial cells. In epithelial tissue, the first name always indicates the number of layers present, while the second name indicates the shape of the cell. Let's look at the number of layers first. If only one cell is present, we call it simple epithelium. Simple epithelium is found where rapid absorption or diffusion occurs, because material can pass really quickly just through one layer of cells. If more than one layer of cells is present, we call the epithelium stratified. Strata means different layers. So stratified epithelium is located in the regions where we need protection against abrasion, against friction and bacteria. Like, for example, the best example for this is skin. Now let us look at the shape of the epithelial cells. First one is, if the cells are flat, we call them squamous. If the cells are cube-like, then we call them cuboidal. And if the cell are like column shaped, then you have guessed it right. Yes, it's columnar. So to summarize, if you are asked to name epithelium, it's very easy. Just we have certain combinations of them. First state the number of cell layers present and then the shape of the cells. Here are some common examples of epithelium. Simple squamous, as the name suggests, because it has one layer and it is flat, that is why squamous. So we can say this is simple squamous. Again, if we have one layer but the shape is cuboid, then the name will be simple cuboidal. Then again, one layer and column like shape, so the name will be simple columnar. In the same way, we have stratified squamous, stratified cuboidal, and stratified columnar. But wait, there is more. Our bodies have two other types of epithelium, which I haven't yet mentioned. These are pseudo-stratified columnar epithelium and transitional epithelium. This is what pseudo-stratified columnar epithelium looks like. Pseudo means fake. The epithelium looks stratified. It just looks. That is why false. It seems to be stratified. It seems to have layers. But actually, it is not stratified, is it? It is single-layered tissue. So there is only one layer of cell present, because of all of the cell touch the basement membrane. So pseudo-stratified columnar epithelial secretes a sticky mucus and has a cilia on its surface. It is found in nasal cavity and where mucus traps dust in the air, preventing it from getting into your lungs. And cilia. Cilia is finger-like structures. They move the dust and mucus towards your throat, where it is swallowed. Finally, let us look at transitional epithelium. Transitional epithelium is a special type of stratified epithelium because it can stretch without breaking. Transitional epithelium is found in bladder because the bladder has to stretch as it fills with urine after some time. And in an empty bladder, the cells are cuboidal in shape, but the bladder fills with urine, so it needs more space now. So the epithelial cells stretch and become squamous in shape. It is because the cells change the shape. So what is change? It is transition. So that is why it is named as epithelium transitional. So I hope that helped you understand how epithelial tissue is classified. Now let us take a look at our next interactive activity to learn more about where each type of epithelial tissue is found in human body and what it does. First one is simple squamous. So it is present inside the lungs, inside the blood vessels and outside of the stomach intestine. The cells are extremely thin and flat and form a delicate lining. As you remember, what is squamous? It's flat structure. Next one is simple cuboidal. So as the name suggests, I hope you remember that it, why it is named simple cuboidal. Because simple because it is one layer, and cuboidal because it is cubical in shape, located in kidney tubules, in ducts of many glands including mammary, the salivary glands, and on the surface of ovaries. Its main function is secretion and absorption. Then is simple columnar. Simple columnar, as the name suggests, single layer of tall, narrow, column-shaped cells. Oval nucleus present near the base of the cell. Some cells have cilia, for example, in case of, we can say, lungs and uterine tubes. And some have microvilli, for example, in case of intestine. They may possess goblet cells, which secrete mucus. So they are present inside stomach, uterus, intestine, gallbladder, uterine tubes, and inside the bronchioles of lungs and some kidney tubules. In case of stomach, intestine and kidney, its function is absorption. In case of stomach, intestine, lungs, uterus and kidney, its function is secretion. And mucus from goblet cells help prevent destruction of stomach lining from acidic gastric juice. The next is stratified squamous. As the name suggests, stratified. So of course it will be multilayered. They'll be present in mouth, esophagus and anus. Then is stratified cuboidal, as the name suggests, there will be two or more layers of cube shaped cells, and this is a rare type of epithelium. It's present in salivary glands, sweat glands and ovaries. Basic function is secretion of gland, ovarian hormones, sperm and protection. Then is stratified columnar. As the name suggests again, stratified, so multiple layers, and columnar, so shape will be column shape. It's present in mammary glands and esophageal glands. So its basic function is protection and limited secretion. So now we have covered all the membranous tissues. Now we'll be discussing about glandular epithelial. So there are basically two types of glandular epithelial tissues. One is endocrine and another is exocrine. Endocrine glands release their secretions into the bloodstream, where it is transported to other parts of the body. So examples of endocrine glands include thyroid and adrenal glands. Whereas exocrine glands release their secretions into ducts. So endocrine releases their secretions into blood, and they are releasing their secretions into ducts, which empty onto a surface or into a cavity. For example, the pancreas, they secrete digestive enzymes that are emptied into small intestine. So that's all. I hope you have found the class informative. Hey, before I end the class, something strikes into my mind. Have you heard about celiac disease? What are some of the clinical symptoms associated with celiac disease? If not, please try and surf the internet. Okay, before I wind up, let's recapitulate.
We learned about basic appearance of epithelial tissue, classification of epithelial tissue, characteristics of epithelial tissue, and functions of epithelial tissue. In the next video, we'll be discussing about connective tissue. I hope you'll enjoy the next session together. Thank you for watching. Please like and subscribe the channel.